we are now a technological species. Aditya L1 mission was talked of in International Living with a Star program for a long time. I am so proud that this mission actually happened. Parker Solar Probe was sent this close to answer two questions. But today, so I kind of want to come back to India. Today, I think the India that I grew up in does not exist anymore.
Guha Thakurta.
We cannot even imagine a life without our star sun, the source of light, heat, and all other forms of energy which we need. So, how important and exciting the study of sun in particular, and how it influences our own planet Earth and other planets in the solar system. Welcome to a new episode of Asianet News Science Talk, and let's explore more about sun with our eminent guest today, the NASA astrophysicist Dr. Madhulika Guhathakurta, Senior Advisor for New Initiatives, the Heliophysics Division of NASA. A versatile scientist, she is mission designer, instrument builder, and directing and managing various science programs of NASA. Dr. Madhulika, welcome to Asianet News Science Talk.
Thank you.
And it's a proud moment for us to having you here for our program. And we appreciate your visit here.
Thank you.
Let's start with what is heliophysics and what's its scope.
It's a very good question, very broad question. A lot of people ask this question because we made this word up in 2005. Our division, the science division, one of the five science divisions at NASA headquarters, always has studied the sun-earth connected science. And that was the name of our division. And in 2005, we changed that to a one-word division, which is heliophysics. Heliophysics, as you can hear from this explanation, is a made-up word. Heliophysics, like astrophysics, is really, astrophysics studies the environment of stars, and heliophysics studies the environment of the sun. Sun and its connectedness, not only to our planet, but every other planet and everything in the solar system, till sun's magnetic field meets up with the interstellar magnetic field, which is the boundary of other stars. So that is sort of the very broad realm of heliophysics. Heliophysics is very, very multidisciplinary. So you're studying the sun as an astrophysics star, but you're also studying the interaction of the sun with our own planet, with our own planet's magnetosphere. Just like the sun has magnetic field, Earth has magnetic field also. That interaction that we study is more like meteorology, like the way Earth science is studied. So, in a nutshell, heliophysics is actually a combination between two disciplines, astrophysics and meteorology. And really, it is the magnetic field both of the sun and of our planet that creates this tremendous interaction that creates different conditions in space, where we have now come to understand that there is this off-world weather, not Earth weather, but space weather. You know, this is a concept that didn't even exist 25 years ago. So heliophysics today is a new discipline, but it is made up of some of the oldest disciplines in the world. In fact, ionospheric physics, you know, it is one of the layers of our outer atmosphere of our own planet that gets energized by sun's extreme ultraviolet radiation. And atmospheric physics had very broad scope in India once upon a time. So heliophysics studies solar physics, magnetospheric physics, ionospheric physics, aeronomy, connection between sun and climate, sun and Mars, sun and Venus. We have spacecraft, Voyagers, that have now entirely left the solar system and they are in interstellar medium. So you can understand how broad this is and how complex and multidisciplinary this field is.
So Voyager sends signals from the outer
outside the solar system.
Yes. And now your new mission, that is Parker solar vehicle, solar probe, sending visuals and samples from very nearest to the sun.
Very good point.
So from two extremes, exactly, you are collecting data.
Exactly.
So how far we know about sun and how far we not yet know?
That's another kind of question that is very broad. Now, over the last 20 years, we have learned a tremendous amount about the sun through our various satellites. SOHO, STEREO mission, Solar Dynamics Observatory, Van Allen probes. These are all Parker solar probe right now. Collaboration between European Space Agency and NASA, the Solar Orbiter mission. So all of these missions.
These LISA projectors.
LISA, yes. So even though LISA is not part of heliophysics, but it's astrophysics, right? But we are learning from each other. Even though there are divisions in science mission directorate, but they are sort of budgetary divisions. Science can't be contained within such walls. So there is always exchange of information.
Interdisciplinary.
With each division. So we have learned a lot, but there is so much more to learn. We still don't know, exactly how solar flares are caused, especially solar X flares, which can be lethal, because then we would like to predict it. Sun has a heartbeat, meaning every 11 years or so, it goes through a cycle. It's called solar cycle. And it goes through a period of maximum when the magnetic field of the sun is pretty intense and the entire surface of the sun is peppered with black dots. They are sunspots. So its maximum number of sunspots is associated with solar max. Minimum number of sunspots, no sunspots, is associated with solar minimum. And so we go through this cycle. And we still don't know what causes this rhythm with any great accuracy or understanding. So there are many questions. Parker Solar Probe, we have created that mission. It's going to reach perihelion, very close to the sun, closest distance, in December of 2024. And the data we have collected so far is mesmerizing, even for a scientist. It's things we haven't seen before. And Parker Solar Probe was sent this close to answer two questions. The sun's outer atmosphere, the corona, which we see during a total solar eclipse, or with telescopes that have a mask in front of it, called occulting disk, so it blocks the glaring view of the sun and you see the outer atmosphere, which is very faint. Now, this atmosphere is very hot, 1 to 2 million degrees Kelvin, whereas the sun that we see, the pale yellow sun that we see is between 5,000 and 6,000 degrees. And so the question is, the intensity, the energy mechanism for the sun is nucleosynthesis, which happens inside the core. That energy propagates out. So common sense tells when you move away from a source of heat, like you move away from a gas stove, the temperature will fall. Well, in this case, abruptly, the temperature increases by a huge amount. While we have many theories, there isn't really good observational confirmation of those theories. You know, what really heats the corona, which ultimately also then accelerates the particles that move out that we call solar wind. So these are some of the challenging questions, not of solar physics. It is, you know, fundamental physics that we are trying to understand.
Then what are the informations we so far processed from these samples?
We have learned quite a bit, but, you know, data is still being collected and scientists are still analyzing it. So we have seen something called switchbacks, rapid change of magnetic flux, for example. Now, we had seen evidence of that in the past from other missions like Helios. But as we are getting closer and closer, the frequency, the number is increasing rapidly. We are seeing wave-particle interactions that we have never observed before. So this is going to give rise to new theories, new insights. I think it will rewrite our solar physics textbooks.
Can I ask some curious questions?
Sure.
From a common person's perspective? What is the original color of sun, or real color? We see it as red at the when it's at the horizon, then blue when at noon, yellow at some other time. So what's the real color of sun?
It's a very good question. So let me start by saying what color is and is not, right? So black is the absence of any wavelength being emitted at us, right? So we see nothing, it's just dark. And white is the combination of all electromagnetic wavelength. Now our eyes only perceive, so electromagnetic wave spectrum is very broad, right? But our eyes only perceive the visible length, visible wavelength of the electromagnetic spectrum. It's a very narrow wavelength. So we see the sun and it looks the same color that we see with our eyes. The reason it looks red during sunset is simply because the atmospheric path increases and the blue light is
scattered
and you see the red. But yellow is yellow. It's a pale yellow color. But when we see the sun through telescopes, and that's why we send telescopes outside of our atmosphere, those telescopes can actually look at the sun in wavelengths that we can't see, like extreme ultraviolet wavelength, like X-rays and infrared. And the sun looks entirely different. So when we look at the sun in visible wavelength, like from, Kovalam Beach here in Kerala, right? It looks like sun is dull and boring. Nothing is happening.
Also, it looks like a solid sphere. Is it a solid sphere?
No, it's not. It's not. But if you see the sun through this other wavelength, it's a seething, bubbling environment. So the sun is a sphere, but I'm going to use the word and then clarify, it's like a ball of gas. But it's not gas as we know it. It's not neutral gas. It's charged particles. And so it's another state of matter, actually called plasma. That's what sun is made of. Electrons, protons, ionized atoms.
So when the temperature increases, we studied in our classes, that pressure decreases. So in the outer corona, when it's at very high temperature, what about the pressure? Pressure lower or more at the center?
So temperature and pressure in this case, you know, it will depend on what kind of pressure you're talking of, kinetic pressure or pressure contained in a chamber, many ways of answering that, right? So pressure is correlated with temperature. But what's happening in the corona, it's not just like a fluid, right? It's not just temperature or gravity. There is magnetic field. So there is interaction with the magnetic field. So you have to look at the magnetic pressure versus the actual particle pressure. And those are very interesting phenomenon. And we look at region where both become the same, and then the magnetic field takes over and particle actually start flowing. I mean, that's what you begin to see. When you get close to the sun, you are beginning to see the changes in these kind of properties. And we are trying to understand that. Where is the boundary? Is the boundary a circle? Well, it's not. Is the boundary a sphere? It's not. It's like everything else, you know, it's messed up. And the closer we get, the more we get to see, but then more questions emerge that we have to answer. And Parker Solar Probe is giving us an incredible, you know, first row view of the sun that we have never had before.
I think in 2021, this Parker probe touched the corona for the first time. NASA announced that. So, and you sampled materials from there and magnetic field also. So any information process?
Yeah, we are continuously doing that. There are many important, you know, science results coming out. Some are verification. Some we didn't anticipate. You know, we are seeing magnetic field structures that we didn't anticipate. For example, we are measuring particles. We are trying to see, you know, we have calculated these properties, right, from our line of sight measurements in the past. And so there is active effort going on. What the sun, what the Parker Solar Probe is measuring locally, called in situ, whether it matches up with our theoretical construct, the magnetic field that we estimated in the corona, does it match many of our magnetohydrodynamic models? And this is active work going on right now. Lot of debate, lot of excitement.
Now, what's your take on India's solar mission, that is Aditya L1?
Oh, this is amazing. You know, Aditya L1 mission was talked of in International Living with a Star program for a long time. We have had actually workshop in Goa on International Living with a Star in 2016, you know, where scientists get together, write up memorandum for the various agencies that this is important, we should do it. So I have to say, I am so proud that this mission actually happened, that it successfully launched, and it successfully got inserted into the Lagrange Point 1 orbit. It's a complicated place to go to, and this was India's first venture. Now we are waiting for really all of the data that the various instruments will be taking. And we have great hopes. There are some instruments that will take observations for the first time. So we are in the beginning stages of discussing how we can collaborate on science utilizing Aditya L1 mission, as well as many of our satellites, right? Like Parker Solar Probe, Solar Dynamics Observatory, to name a few. And then there are future missions that are going to be launching. And so
those missions. Our Gaganyaan project, heard that NASA will give training for our astronauts.
Yes, that's an entirely different branch of NASA. So we are the Science Mission Directorate. Then there is the Exploration Directorate that essentially trains astronauts, you know, launches astronauts to space, all of that. And so that while our science is very important for exploring space, but that is a very different technical side of NASA. And we provide our knowledge, provide the radiation environment when the astronauts are doing extravehicular activity. So if there's something happening on the sun, so they are forewarned. And this will become very important when we actually land on the moon again. Because once you are outside of Earth's magnetosphere, we are no longer protected from the hazard of radiation that comes from the sun as well as other distant stars.
How this knowledge of sun enhances the knowledge of other stars?
Both ways. So, you know, this is the star that we can study in great detail, right? From his birth to death, we can actually map it out. So think of Chandrasekhar, who actually created the whole theory of stellar structure. It still amazes me how we, sitting here on this planet, can theorize such ideas. And an agency like NASA then has to verify the truthfulness of it. And today,
very young age, he calculated it.
Yeah. So, yes, sun played a very important and significant role. This is the only star we can study in the detail that we are studying. But remember, sun is still a very ordinary star, but it is extraordinary for all our purposes.
How this solar flare, this magnetosphere influences our life here?
Yes, so 100 years ago, you know, when we studied the sun, it was just pure curiosity-driven science. But as our societies advance and we got technologically vested, it is no longer kind of curiosity-driven science. It is science with societal relevance. That is the program I talk about a lot. I led it for a long time, Living with a Star. So it is the intersection of those signs that is both curiosity driven and has relevance to life and society. So how, what about it that makes it connected to society? Solar radiation, these particles that are flowing out continuously like a breeze, and sometimes it gets gusty with electrons and protons primarily. When there are big storms on the sun that we call solar flares or coronal mass ejections, big bubble of material coming out of, like being expelled from the sun, this creates a condition in space, highly charged, right? And they come interact with all of the outer atmospheres of our planet. First, the magnetosphere, and there is just the collision of the two magnetospheres, sun and our own. And there is a lot of electromagnetic fluctuation created in the process that will propagate down to the soil, basically, and create its conduction of this voltage fluctuation that can trip transformers, that can create blackout. That is probably the most sort of powerful impact we can imagine on our planet. And if you are a country in high latitude, because the Earth's magnetic field is, you know, tilted and but closer to the north than the south pole of our planet, then these particles kind of propagate through that. And those are the, so high latitude countries are more affected by this than equatorial countries. But then every electromagnetic kind of object can suffer, you know, signal disruption, right? So for example, think about AsiaNet. How many satellites do you have? Let me ask you some questions. How many satellites do you have to broadcast all your information? Do you know? You have satellites, right, that will beam information out. So those satellites can actually get interrupted by such mechanism, by solar flares or coronal mass ejection. And if the satellite communication is lost, then there is no TV. That's just one. You know, everything in space is susceptible to what happens on the sun. But if we can do a good job of predicting the arrival of this disruption, like a coronal mass ejection, then we can tell the satellite operators to take mitigating steps tell them to turn off their sensitive equipment so they won't be affected by these electromagnetic fields. There are many others, but the main point is that we are now a technological species. We are technologically vested as society. And so studying the sun is no longer just a curiosity. It is a necessity. It's not a choice anymore.
So that's your answer to the critics of spending more money on space exploration rather than for humans.
Absolutely. We have to continue. You know, people raise good points, but it's not a either or. We often ask very binary questions, as if you can do this and not that. No. We have to be practical, mindful, and do the most we can.
NASA provides pictures and data free for all research persons all over the world. So media also free to use those visuals. And what's your take on when compared to the Indian scenario?
Well, I can't take what my take is, but I can take a position and say it's a proud heritage of NASA to share all its data, right? And think of what that has led to. People are always afraid of sharing data as a new nation kind of sending satellites sometimes because they think that their scientists won't get credit from the data, that someone else will use their data. And we got over that sort of sentiment at NASA a long time ago. And the goal was that the more you share your data, the more people will use it and the greater the scientific discovery. You have opened up a space. The entire world today, has heliophysics as one of its themes in science, but we started it. So think about like how important that is. If you just kept it to ourselves, the entire world wouldn't have benefited. That's the way I think.
So in that way also you are benefiting the society.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
My general message is that science, you know, has no borders, no boundaries. We have to work collaboratively. That is the only way we survive as a species to really kind of deal with very many of the challenges that we face as a species on our own planet.
Women in science, are you still feel that women is underrepresented in science, or what's your opinion in this regard and in India and also at the US?
That's also an interesting question. Very clearly, you know, nature didn't discriminate, right? So there's 50% women, 50% men as population goes. So why are there so few women in science or technology? And I'd point my finger to society, basically. It's a societal evolution where we have to take steps to make that place an equal place for all, because women bring not just the scientific bent, we all have that. You know, men are not special, neither are women, but we bring different diverse set of qualities as being a man and a woman. And women bring empathy to any kind of dialogue, you know, solving problems. So having diverse opinion in any discussion we are having, you know, whether it's science or politics or culture, it is absolutely essential. So I'm not going to isolate just science. It's necessary everywhere. And we should be mindful of that.
And multi-ethnicity also.
All of it. Diversity of opinion. It has nothing else to do. And the diversity of opinion from different ethnic group comes from their different cultural background. You asked me a question, so I'll give you an answer about my own kind of life journey. When I was in India, you know, I was a pretty good student. And in my university days, when I was doing MSc at University of Delhi, there were 100 students. There were 50 men, 50 women. And we didn't discriminate a woman if she was smarter than the men. It's the same teenage, early 20 interaction that young kids have. But that was different when I went to USA. There were very few women in science.
It's surprising. US is an advanced country.
Well, that's what you would have thought. But today, so I kind of want to come back to India. Today, I think the India that I grew up in does not exist anymore. That's kind of just, my observation, very limited observation.
So as a religion gripping every field, politics, society, etc., how you view science communication as a tool to improve the scientific temper of the people, which is the ultimate need of the society?
Yes. Religion to me is kind of seeking spirituality, and you
now
take
more
any.
Now more wealth is spending for constructing temples.
Well, I mean, again.
Not only Ayodhya, states are just like.
But I'm not going to address, specifics, but I'd like to sort of compare religion to seeking something that's beyond the realm of anything else. And to me, I call that spirituality. Okay. And every country, every ethnicity will find their own way and own rituals to pursue that quest for getting answers to our fundamental needs for spirituality. That's how I view it. And science is merely taking information from the natural world that we are giving a framework to and saying, look, science works, methods of science work. Think of eclipses. We can predict eclipses, right?
Yeah.
How do we do that? I mean, these are sort of when there are natural events occurring, we should bring people, right? Young, old, all alike, and say that this is not magic. We calculated this. We calculated this 2,000 years ago. That is science. That's the power of mathematics. So it's a dialogue. It's teaching, training, culture. It is not saying anything is better or anything is worse. We are all in it together,
so
trying to understand the universe and our journey in it.
We all are the children of our star.
That is absolutely true. Beautifully said. And we will go back to the stars.
In 2017, you are the lead scientist for the total solar eclipse observer. So how exciting it was?
Oh, the eclipses are very intense, truly magical moments. They are inspirational, spiritual, it has so many dimensions, but you are also seeing a most spectacular view that you cannot see in anything else. It's a phenomenon of the cosmos. I would say if anyone ever gets an opportunity to see a total solar eclipse where you can see the outer atmosphere of the sun, the corona. It has a color a little bit like my hair actually now. It is incredible. It is short, but it just leaves you mesmerized and in wonder.
So it's a rare opportunity to study the corona also.
Very rare opportunity. And so 2017, America was incredibly lucky that we were able to track the total solar eclipse from coast to coast, from Oregon all the way to East Coast, over, I think, something like a long stretch of time, 90 minutes. And so you know, we tried to galvanize the community, kind of working on citizen science, all other ideas, lots of instruments, you know, observing from the ground, from balloon, from airplanes. It's very important for science also. So during a total solar eclipse, we can see the very beginning of the corona. And that's where lots of interesting physics processes are happening. Now, when we observe the corona with our telescopes by putting a mask and occulting disk, we can't get that close to the origin of the corona. So we don't have good measurements for that region. So doing these measurements kind of give us more data points. We try to build new kind of spectrometers, telescopes. We design this, we meaning the greater scientific community, before they fly in space, because you kind of have to have some demonstration that something like this
will
work.
You work as a data scientist also. How this versatility achieved?
Well, I mean, all scientists, if you're not just a pen and paper scientist, right, only working on computer, if you're working on computer, even then you're a data scientist. We all work with data, right? I mean, so I think scientists were probably the first data scientists. Now it's become a new field.
Then how a stargazing kid from Bengal reached this position? We would like to hear that exciting story also. Who influenced you to come to astrophysics or to choose science?
It's not so much the influence of any one individual. It's again, it's a culture, it's a family. It's my grandmother, you know, dying when I was very young and I was very close to her. These are just, you know, flashes of memory. And I think someone told me that when people die, they become stars. Maybe it started from there. Maybe it started from going to build a planetarium, you know, seeing, you know, the artificial dots of light, but thinking how spectacular this is. It's the curiosity of the natural world. I think we all have it.
What prompted you to go to US for a PhD?
That's personal reason. I finished my MPhil and I was hoping to go there for my postdoc, but I went there earlier.
What's your message to astrophysics aspirants or this heliophysics? The future scientists.
Don't get impossible in the way of what you're doing. A lot of people will say, right, you can't do this, you can't do that. No, those are not words in my vocabulary. You have to keep trying. Keep trying. Know your passion. Don't do it to be at a place. You know, often I hear from young people, they want to work at NASA. But why? What is your goal? What do you want to do? What do you want to understand? So be driven by your passion and keep pushing. There is no shortcut.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for finding time to spend with us and sharing this valuable knowledge. And it's like a perfect classroom experience. And while talking, you're enjoying the subject. That is, we see it as a vision.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.